Says, now when he had ended all his sayings in the audience of the people, he entered into Capernaum. And a certain centurion's servant, who was dear unto him, the centurion, was sick and ready to die. And when he, the centurion, heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him, Jesus, that he, Jesus, would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. For he loveth our nation, and he hath built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them, and when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof. Wherefore neither thought I myself worthy to come to thee, but say a word, and my servant shall be healed. For I also am a man set under authority, having under me soldiers. And I say unto one, go, and he goeth, and unto another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doth it. And when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turned him about, and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. And they that were sent, returning to the house, found the servant whole that had been sick. Back to verse 7. Wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but say a word. Subject this afternoon, say a word. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this worship opportunity. We ask now for the next few minutes that you would speak through the power of your Holy Spirit. Say a word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let God's people say, amen and amen. This morning we sang, Give Me the Bible. How many of you are glad for the Word of God today? I thank God for the Bible. Someone has said that the Bible contains the mind of God, the state of man, the way of salvation, the doom of sinners, and the happiness of believers. That the Bible has doctrines that are holy, precepts that are binding, histories that are true, that its decisions are immutable, that we should read it to be wise, believe it to be safe, and practice it to be holy. Somebody want to say amen. Amen. For the Bible has light to direct you and food to support you and comfort to cheer you. For the traveler, it's a map. To the pilgrim, it's a staff. To the pilot, it's a compass. To the soldier, it's a sword. And to the Christian, it is the GPS to get us to heaven. Basic instructions before leaving earth. What are you saying? In the Bible, we read that paradise is restored. Heaven is open and the gates of hell fall off their hinges. Christ is the theme of the Bible. Our good, its design. And the glory of God, its end. I thank God for the Bible. It should fill our memory, rule our hearts, guide our feet. We should know that it's given to us in life, will be opened in the judgment and remembered forever. For it involves the highest responsibility, will reward the greatest labor, and will condemn all who trifle with its sacred content. I thank God for the Bible. The word of the living God. And so this afternoon, I'm praying for a word. How about you? I'm praying that God will give us a word today from the Bible. Luke chapter 7 tells us that Jesus ended all of his sayings. What he means is that Jesus had just finished his sermon on the mount. Some scholars say that that sermon was hours long. Mine will be just under an hour. Aren't you glad for that? But even though it was hours long, because no man spoke like Jesus, not a man moved. I hope nobody moves here today. Unless you're coming to the front to give Jesus your heart. Come on and say amen. I hope you are moved by the word today to give your heart to him. What do you say? Now, the Bible says that he ended all his sayings. I like that phrase, that he ended all his sayings. It kind of reminds me of Genesis chapter 2, where the Bible says, and God ended all his work, which he had created and made. Aren't you glad that God is not only the Alpha, but he is the Omega? Oh, I wish I had a church. I said, he's not only the beginning, but he's also the end. See, if you say amen, I'll cut my sermon short. I know you got it. I said, he is the first, and he is the last.
And I'm so glad that Jesus is able to finish what he starts. That gives me hope. When the Bible says he ended his sayings, it lets me know that he can finish whatever he starts. One day he was in Samaria talking to a woman at the well, and she got converted. He was so filled up with the Holy Ghost that when the disciples brought the lunch back, he said, "I'm not hungry." And they wondered who fed him. He said, "My meat is to do the will of God and to finish his work." Because he's not only great at starting, but your God is a great finisher. In fact, the Bible lets us know in John 17 that he said, "Father, I have finished the work that you gave me to do." Even on the cross, before he hung his head and died, he said, "It is finished." You ought to know that he is the author and the finisher of your faith. So that if you find yourself somewhere caught in the middle and struggling with your project, struggling with your salvation, you ought to know that he that hath begun, I wish I had a church in here, a good work in you will complete it and bring it home. Come on and talk to me. You know, when you look at sports, especially the Olympics, I love to watch the Olympics. And particularly as I watch the Olympics, I like to see the relay races. It's an awesome thing as the team goes out there. Now, I believe that the job of the first guy is to get out of the blocks as quick as he can and give the team a lead. Come on and say amen. Like some of you, we are great starters. We are sprinters. I'm going somewhere. I said we're sprinters. We get excited, especially when nominations have taken place and we have new vision. We get started out of the blocks. Come on and talk to me. We're sprinters. So I said the first guy, he's a sprinter to get us out of the blocks. The second guy, I believe, and I had no education in all of this. I'm just thinking. I'm just the preacher's imagination. I think that the second guy is to build on the momentum, and then give it to the third one. Now, I think his job is crucial. The third guy, I think, is to continue that speed, but his main job, come on and help me now, is to get it to the anchor, to give it to Usain Bolt. Because and watch this, the one who's at the end, the finisher, is faster than all of them. Can I get a witness? But I'm glad that God says that he can start things and he can finish things. And one day he that shall come will come. Come on and talk to me. I'm glad that he is not just the author, but my God is the finisher, because he intends to finish whatever he starts. I'm playing with this thing here. I don't like it now. I'm going back to paper notes. Because every time I get caught up preaching, I got to go back and put the passcode in. Maybe somebody can help the poor preacher get tech savvy. But I just want to say that God can start things and he can finish things. In fact, the book of Romans tells us that he, God, not Iran, not Iraq, not Russia, not Germany, he, God, will finish the work. And that he's going to cut it short in righteousness. So if you and I are struggling in the middle of your Christian experience, losing gas, losing your way, you ought to anchor yourself in somebody who is also a finisher. I said, if you started school, know that he can help you finish. Come on and say amen. I said, if you started on your Christian journey, you don't have to give up and give out and give in. You can hang with Christ and you can finish the race. For henceforth is laid up for you a crown of righteousness to those who finish. And you ought to know this, that the race is not to the swift, but unto him that endures, Elder Musson, to the end. So let's not just be great starters, but let's be great finishers as well. I thank God that he is a finisher. Now the Bible says he ended all his sayings, referring to the sayings on the mount. Sayings like, blessed are the poor in spirit, and blessed are those that hunger and thirst after righteousness, and blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth, and blessed are the pure in heart. But he has some other hard sayings like, love your enemies. all his sayings. You know, we like those other ones, but he has some other sayings. And as he finishes his sayings, he heads into Capernaum. Now, Capernaum is where John and James, Peter, and Andrew are from. Capernaum became the place where it was the center of his ministry. Capernaum was blessed because in Capernaum, he worked some mighty works. But Capernaum did not respond well to the sayings of Jesus. It's interesting that after thousands heard his sayings, Jesus went into a very hard location, to a place where people rejected his sayings. In fact, you ought to know this, that Capernaum is the place where Jesus listed in Matthew 11, along with others, a woe unto them. Turn to Matthew. What book did we say? Matthew chapter 11. What chapter? Matthew 11, and right around verse 23, Jesus has a word for Capernaum, a place that was blessed, a place that was privileged, a place that saw God work, a place that saw miracles, a place where Peter's mother-in-law was healed, a place where the man filled with evil spirits was delivered, a place where some friends took somebody to a house and the press was so great around the house that they had to cut the roof open and they dropped him. All of that took place in Capernaum. So Capernaum was blessed with the teachings of Christ, and Capernaum was blessed with the mighty miracles of Christ. But with great privilege comes responsibility. For in Capernaum, we find that Capernaum has got a woe against it. Matthew chapter 11, and the Bible says right there in verse 23. Well, before that, let me slip up to verse 21. Woe unto thee, Chorazin. Woe unto thee, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at that day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. Here are people who had all the blessings. But again, with blessings, ladies and gentlemen, comes responsibility, for to whom much is given, much is required. In other words, when you know that it was God that did it, you ought to give him praise. And not exalt yourself as those did in Capernaum. When God picks you up from your sick bed, you ought to repent and say, God, you've been so good to me. I need to surrender my all to you. See, the goodness of God is not just good to make you happy on Sabbath and praise the Lord. The goodness of God is designed to help us confess our sins and forsake our sins and to turn around from our evil ways. For the goodness of God is supposed to lead us to repent. Don't become a stuffy, self-righteous Christian because you know the truth and you've got the truth and everybody else is wrong. My question to you is, does the truth possess you? And if it does, it'll change and transform you, because to whom much is given, much will be required of those who think that they know the truth and who think that they're on their way to heaven and yet look down on their noses at those who don't know what you know. Bible says of Judas, it would have been better for him not to have known the way of righteousness than for him to know it and turn from it. So I just thought I'd help us who find ourselves in Capernaum, because to whom much is given, much is definitely required. I tell you, I think that you and I don't need more sermons. In fact, we become so complacent, because we've heard all the E.E. Clevelands. Come on and talk to me. We've heard the C.D. Brookses, the Henry Monroe Wrights, the Walter Pearsons, the Barry Blacks. Come on and talk. The John Nixons, the Gene Donaldsons, the James Duggins, the Westin. We've heard them all. And really, our need is not another sermon. Our need is to obey the word that we already know. So that if you never get another sermon. In fact, the more sermons we hear, the more jeopardy we're in. If our obedience is not equivalent with our education. I think that, like one preacher said, we are saturated, educated above the level of our obedience. And that's dangerous. For it would have been better for us not to have known than to know and not do. That's why people come to me and say, Pastor, what about the lost books of the Bible? My answer is, let them be lost. I'm glad enough to try to live up to right here. Come on and talk to me. And that's why you ought to come to Sabbath school in the morning and learn next week that unless your practice matches your profession, come on and talk to me. Your name may be on the church books, but it can be lost in the books of heaven. Come on and talk to me. Don't come slipping in here late and think that, oh, preacher's getting too late. I'm going to go home and eat my veggie links. You better get yourself in the word of God. We're becoming complacent because we know it all. Oh, nobody. One person said to me, you can't teach me anything. Church member now. Can't teach me anything. Like they know it all now. I know it all. I know all the doctrines. Know all the teachings. Ain't nothing new. Under the sun, I come to church if I want to, when I want to, how I want to. I tell you what, you know too much. You're spoiled. And spoiled children get spanked by the Lord. Come on and talk. Need some spankings. Well, let me get out of that. I was just passing through Samaria. I was just passing through Capernaum. I was just entering into Capernaum. Capernaum got me into that. Okay. Now the Bible says that the centurion had a servant. He was a slave who was sick. His slave, his servant was sick. And it's wonderful that a centurion, a Roman soldier, would even care for a slave. Because to Roman soldiers, slaves are tools. Remember when Jesus was climbing the hill with his cross? Nobody would help him to bear the cross. And a black brother from Africa came along. And they said, hey, you, come here and bear this cross. Somebody said, I think, someone scholar said, black people have been bearing crosses ever since. But everybody is bearing the cross because must Jesus bear the cross alone? And all the world go free? No, but what I'm saying is the Roman centurion, he had authority. And he didn't care. You were just another number because he had authority. But in this case, this centurion has a servant and his servant is sick. And the servant is dear to the centurion, and he gets word. He hears, the Bible says, about Jesus. Now, what I like about this text, it says that the man was ready to die. And when you look at what scholars have to say, scholars say, yes, he had palsy, and he was very sick unto death. But it was not just talking about his physical sickness. He had gotten to a place where he was ready to die. In other words, he was so sick and tired of being sick and tired. You know, there are some people who have died prematurely, because you move them to Agape House. And when they learn of their condition, they shut the mind down and the body just followed. Have you ever known somebody like that? People that just gave up on life because life was not going their way. In fact, there are a lot of people in Bermuda like that who are giving up on life. In fact, could be some people in this church today who have given up on your hopes and your dreams because you have not progressed. And it doesn't make sense being faithful. And you're about to give up the ghost. But you ought to know that while this brother, this servant, was giving up the ghost, there was a centurion. Thank God the centurion cared about him. You ought to be thankful that there are some centurions in your life. That while you have given up on yourself, somebody has not given up on you. 2010, I started my doctoral program. And then I got there, I went through orientation. And when I saw all the computer stuff that I had to do, I said, man, this roster ain't computer savvy. I can't handle that. And all my work is going to be by computer. I'm still in the dark ages, man. And I said, I can't keep up with the professor. Bring your laptop. I had me a laptop, but I couldn't keep up since the ground. I was trying to keep up. I said, I'm wasting my time here. And so I packed my bags. You heard me? I packed my bags. Sponsored by Bermuda Conference, but I packed my bags. And I went to a friend who I found in class. And I said, my brother, I said, listen, man. I said, I can't keep up with you guys. You guys have got it going on. I can't do this. I'm out of here. In fact, if I leave now, I got 3 hours to catch that flight out of LAX. I'm see you. I'll check you later. He said, Ken, sit down. And I sat down. I was in the pastor's office now. And he began to tell me his story. He said, I don't even belong here. Because I'm living in abject poverty. Came from a third world country. He said, I don't have the first dime to be, but I'm here. He said, he kept telling me his story. I said, man, if you can make it with what you got, I can do it too. Come on, say, because he was my centurion. I was ready to give up. But I thank God for the centurions who are here. And by the way, I sit in a church like this, but do you not know that we can multiply this congregation of those who are on our books but are not here today? Who need centurions like you to pick up the phone. Come on and talk to me. And call them and say, I haven't seen you today. So everybody, it's good to have a centurion in your life. Because there are too many people who are giving up on their lives a little too soon. Giving up and ready to die. Well, the centurion got word to Jesus, the Bible says, because he heard about him. Now, in Matthew, it talks about a personal interview that he had with Jesus. But Luke's story is that he heard about Jesus first. And this speaks to the need for us who know Jesus or who claim to know Jesus to tell somebody else about Jesus. The Bible doesn't tell me how he heard about him. It doesn't tell me that he witnessed the mighty acts. The Bible lets me know that he heard about him. Perhaps he heard about him because he had a servant girl somewhere on the job. I'm not talking about the girl in the Bible. I'm talking about you. I said your personal witness and testimony on the job helps people to hear about the Savior. And some people will say, well, Pastor, I can't testify. But the fact of the matter is you testify all the time. You testify. What is a testimony? A testimony is about something that you have experienced. Come on and talk to me. And people are testifying all the time, whether good, bad, or ugly. Because you testify. If you're an Arsenal fan, you're testifying. Oh, I'm sorry, no cricket, no soccer fans in here? If you're a golfer, you testify when your boy comes through. Well, let me help you. If you got a raise, you testify. Come on and say, man. That's why your tithe is going up. Your offering shall follow. But you testify about whatever is on your mind. And that's why when on the day of Pentecost, the Bible says that Peter was full of the Holy Ghost. He preached and 3,000 people heard the gospel. But he was testifying about what he knew. And we need some more testimonies in church. We need more people who are filled with the Holy Ghost. Because the truth of the matter is, you will speak what you're full of. So then if you are full of gossip, that's what you'll speak. You're testifying that you are a gossiper. If you're full of anger, then you'll tell your story to somebody to get it off your chest. If you're envious and you just don't like somebody, you're going to tell somebody because you're full of it. But how many of you are full of Jesus Christ and you just tell somebody that it was the good Lord that brought you through and you're full of power and full of joy and full of happiness because you testify that the Lord is good? Because of what he has done for you. Hallelujah, somebody. He gives us the opportunity to testify. This man heard about Jesus, which lets me know that faith comes by hearing. And hearing what? The word of God. See, your testimony is like a seed planted into the hearts of those that you talk to. And that's why when kids go Disney World, they tell their friends, and next thing you know, somebody's mama's got to get some money ready because they heard about Disney World. Come on and talk to me. Well, when they hear your testimony, somebody ought to run to Jesus because of what he's done for you. Well, the Bible says in verse 4 that when they came to Jesus, they besought Jesus and told Jesus that the centurion was worthy
for whom he should do this. Verse 5 tells you why they thought he was worthy. He said, we already know here that he was a compassionate man. But they said because he, we already know he loved his servant and treated others right. But we already know he had a good reputation because here is a Roman who has enough clout to get elders that are Jews to go call Jesus to his house. So he had to have a good reputation in the community. Mm-hmm. But look what they say recommends him to Jesus. They tell Jesus, listen, this guy's got a need. You need to go see him. I'll tell you why. He loves our nation and he has built us a church. So Lord, please go over to his house and heal his servant. Now, while they are bigging this centurion up and telling Jesus why he is worthy, it's interesting when you get down to verse 7 that the brother says he didn't think himself worthy. He said, I didn't come to you in the first place because I'm not worthy. And then later on in the text, when Jesus gets a little closer to the house, he sends his friends. He said, hey, man, tell Jesus, don't bother come over here. Why? Because I'm not worthy. And then let me just say this. Some people think that you're worthy because of your accomplishments. Some people think that you're worthy because of your education. Some people think that you're worthy because of what you have done. And that's how the Jews used to think. That if you're done that, you must be saying something. But thank God for a centurion who is born outside of the church, who knows that his worthiness is not in his success. That he is that no matter how much I succeed in life, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I am undone. Can't make it without him. And the minute you think that because of your position and your status and your family connections, the minute you think that you are something, God's got a word for you. Nobody's worthy. And the only person that really has access to God is the man that, or the woman that knows, Lord, I'm undone. Kumbaya here, Lord. I need you, Lord. So whilst he had position and clout and all of that authority, he knew that when it comes to God, God is not looking on all the trophies on your shelf. He's not looking at your business or how much money you have. He doesn't care how long you've been in the church, who your mama is and who your daddy is. Nothing in my hands I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. If we're worthy, it's because he accounts us worthy. And your righteousness, you ought to know this morning, sorry to hurt your feelings, but the Bible says your righteousness is like filthy rags. And go home and study that. I won't take time to study that, give you what that really means. I won't tell you from the desk what that really means. Go home. Some things in the Bible are so strong, you can smell them. In other words, all your good works smells. And without the righteousness of Christ, we are nothing. Come on and talk to me. So thank God for a brother who has not lost his own sense of his unworthiness. And that's a secret to staying close with God. Because God resisteth the proud. But for those of the humble and the contrite, and for those who know that they can't make it without him, for those who know that I need you every hour, I need you. God is attracted to somebody like that. Two people in the Bible came to church to pray. One who came down front and he was all that, and he saw another guy at the back door and he said, Lord, I thank you that I'm not like that brother. I thank you that I've returned tithe, and I thank you that you have blessed me and I know the word of God. I thank you you've made me a teacher and an elder. I thank you for how you blessed my family. I thank you I'm not like that guy back there. And the guy back there said, Lord, have mercy on me. And the author says, whose prayer do you think got to heaven? One prayer went bouncing all off the walls. The highest place it got was the ceiling. But the brother who was contrite and humble got a prayer through. And Jesus uses a Roman soldier in Capernaum to help self-righteous Christians understand what he truly values. He truly values somebody who is not impressed with their own press. And it's better for others to be impressed about you than to be impressed about yourself. Come on and talk to me. After all, we all have to get up and brush our teeth. We all have to get up and put one foot in front of the other. We are all unworthy. And the thing that makes any of us worth anything is our connection with God. And if you ain't got that, and all you have is some stuffy religious beliefs, then you ain't got nothing on salvation. Come on and talk to me. And by the way, that's why some people are unhappy unless you recognize them. In fact, some people's self-esteem and worthiness comes in what they can do in church. And if you take that away, they fall apart. Because they have learned, or they got the false notion that what I do makes me something. Let me give you a word from the gospel. Nothing you can do makes you something. Jesus makes you something. Come on and talk to me. That's why some people have low self-esteem. And unless you toot their horn, they can't make it. But then there are some people who don't care who gets the credit, because they know that it's not about them, it's about Jesus. What do you say? All right, we can move on, Pastor, to that one. So I'm interested in another portion of the scripture, if I can find the rest of the sermon. Amen, I found it. Whew. Thank you, Jesus. I'm glad I found it, because I wouldn't know what to do. So check this. The Bible says that he understands himself. You got to know yourself. Then it says in verse 8, he realizes as he comes to Jesus with this request. He says to Jesus, you don't have to, because I'm a man under authority. And because of that, I am able to command people with the authority that I have. It's really an expression of faith when he says, bother yourself to come all the way over here, because as one under authority, I have people under me. And when I say go, they go. They come. When I say do this, they do it. Because I am a man under authority. Notice he didn't say I'm a man with authority, because he knows that his authority comes not from himself, but comes from Rome. What he's saying is, if I can do that as a Roman soldier, when I go out with my dress on, my sword and my shield on, they know I'm a Roman centurion. They do what I say. Because they all come under Caesar, and I represent Caesar. And what it's actually saying, I know that you come under God. And that because you come representing God, you don't even have to make your way to my house. All you got to do is say a word. Just say the word, Jesus. Because I understand that I'm a man under authority. Meaning that a police officer, you got some police officers in here today. Now, they don't look like much today. You can probably talk to them any way you want to today. But let them put on their uniform. They are under authority. And they can say stop. They can say go. Or they can say come with me. And some of you know what that feels like. Because they were under authority. And they represented a higher power.
And so the man says, I'm taking my own experience to liken what you can do, Jesus, because you represent all power. And you don't have to make your way over to the house. Just speak a word. He sounds like he's a Christian, because only Christians should know that when he speaks, things happen. Maybe he heard that there was a bad storm out North Shore, and the disciples were kicking and scrambling, and he was asleep in the boat. And they said, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he woke up and he stood up and said, hush, be still. And the winds and the waves obeyed his voice. Speak a word, Lord. Jesus was so impressed. He said, did you hear that? I've been doing miracles in Israel, but I've never heard anybody express faith like that in all of Israel. He marveled at him. Now, you and I need to understand something for our own lives, because Christians are supposed to have authority, but we only have authority because we are under God's authority. Did he not tell his disciples, I will give you the keys to the kingdom? He said, whatever you ask in my name, it shall be done. He said, man, you are going to tread on serpents and scorpions. Even demons will be subject unto you. Now, it's important that you understand that you've got to be under authority in order to have authority. Because there were some who went out preaching in Paul's name, and the devil looked at that brother and said, Jesus, I know. And Paul, I know. But you ain't got no power in your life. You're faking it. And that's a rebuke to those of us who profess to be Christians but want to live our own private lives, because we had not yet learned to come under God's authority. It means that you and I have to surrender to a higher power and be converted so that you can have his power in your life. We need spiritual power. And the only way you get spiritual power is that you have surrendered your power to him who has all power. In other words, is God the number one authority in your life? Or is he just that sometimes? So first lesson, if we're going to have power to claim his word, then we need to surrender to his word. Otherwise, we will not have that authority. In other words, we got to learn to put aside your own opinions and your own likes and dislikes, because it don't matter, because it's not about you when you say that you're a Christian. It's now about God's opinion in your life. You don't see people on the battlefield arguing with the general. All they want to know is, what do you want us to do? And they go ahead and do it. And we need more Christians who will not fuss with Jesus Christ and do your own thing. By the way, centurions, they dress like centurions. I said centurions look like centurions. And if a centurion understands his instructions, it will be good for us to understand our instructions. And I need to ask you, whose instructions are you following? Or are you living your own life? But if you want to come out and have Christian promises on your behalf, then you got to live under his authority. By the way, when you are under the authority of someone else, they take care of you. When I was conference secretary, and even now, I get to preach 5 to 8 times overseas. When I leave here, I don't pay a dime, because I'm going under the authority of somebody else. Mm-hmm. Feels mighty good, too. I didn't pay for the ticket, and I ride coach. You thought I was going to say first class. I ride coach, but it's free. I get off, and my car is assigned to me, and I don't pay a dime. I go to the restaurant, and I eat whatever I woulda eat. And I take them the bill. Come on and say amen. I go to the hotel and I chill. Don't hate on the brother. I said I chill. And I enjoy every minute of it. Because I'm under the authority of the one who asked me to leave my house and go on assignment. Well, you ought to know as a Christian that when you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you came under his authority. And he will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory. Somebody ought to thank God this morning. Which means that my problems are his. My bills, praise God, are his. He'll make a way somehow. I just got to be faithful. Come on and talk to me, saints. Because it's nice to be under his authority. And yea, though I have to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, if I got to die under his authority, I'll come back up. So it's nice to be under his authority. That's why the brother said, Lord, don't trouble yourself. You can speak. Don't the Bible say that he commanded and it stood fast? Come on and talk to me. Let me let you out of here because you're looking at me like, Now you can lose that authority by stepping out of that authority. You've seen people who were sponsored, who lost their sponsorship because of their disobedience. Well, I'm trying to help you get your next prayer answered. You don't just think you have a sugar daddy who's just going to give you everything because you call on his name. He wants you to stay under his authority. What I'm saying is he wants you to represent him so that he can make you look good. And when he makes you look good, you make him look good. I wish I had a church in here today. So when you're under authority, he takes care of you. The man just said to Jesus, say a word. Now, you never see in this text where Jesus said anything. It just says that Jesus marveled. I read the text in Luke 7. You don't see where he says, and the Lord said. It just says, man, did you hear that? I'm talking about Jesus. That's what Jesus said. He turned around, he said, did you all hear that? Which lets me know that when you and I are under his authority and have put our lives in his hand and we ask him to help us to do his will, he gets happy. And he starts working on your stuff without having to say a word. He starts activating his promises on your behalf. How many of you know that you got your job not because you had connections, but not because you knew the boss, but not because somebody was in the family? In fact, they were trying to give it to somebody else, but it just landed in your lap. Come on and talk to me, because he opens doors. I said he makes a way out of no way. I wish I had a chance. I said he makes a way out of no way. That's the kind of God he is. He can speak and make things happen, or he can just make it happen without having to speak. And that's why when your faith connects with God's word, miracles take place. Can I get a witness? He didn't know how God could do it, but he knew that God could do it. And that's why I want to say in closing that faith doesn't focus on the challenge or the degree of difficulty. Faith focuses on him who made the promise. And when you focus on what God said, by the way, when you pray the word, that's a good way to pray. You can pray, Lord, you said in your word that if I'm faithful, that you would come through for me. Lord, in your word, You told me that if I return a faithful tithe and offering, you'll take care of me. You tell me that you will supply all my needs according to your riches in glory. Faith chooses rather to cast its lot and to give its attention to the credibility of the one who makes the promise. And I thank God that the word of God is filled with promises. What do you say? For the Bible tells you and me that at his word, red seas stand up at attention. Come on and talk to me. At his word, the Red Sea opened up. At his word, prophets shut up the heavens with a preacher's sermon. At his word, worlds were spun into existence. At his word, ravens fed prophets. At his word, slingshots killed 12-foot uncircumcised giants. At his word, rams are found in thickets. At his word, shouts tumble strong walls. At his word, friends come out of graves and lions lie down like house dogs and muddy waters cleanse leprosy and folks on Social Security for 35 years have a baby. At his word, drunks become deacons and two-footed devils become preachers. At his word. What your challenge is, but the answer to your life is found in his word. And I thank God that there's a word for your situation today, but you gotta come under his authority. You gotta surrender and be willing to live under his authority, because he wants you to represent him, and he's not just doing it for you, he's doing it that his name may be glorified. And he needs people today to rightly represent him so that he can get the glory. Not just by what we say, but by how we live. So today, the challenge for us is, are we living by the word? And today is an invitation for us to say, Lord, I can't even remember the last time I opened the word. Perhaps some of us today don't have a word download in our lives, but today God wants to help us to be filled with his word. And you ought to, your prayer ought to be, Lord, order my steps in your word. And wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed to the word. And thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. In the beginning was the word. And his word is going to be around a long time. So you might as well get used to it. Come on and talk to me. Don't be like those in Capernaum who reject the word. But be like the centurion who says, Lord, just say the word. He says that he has a willingness to obey all of God's word. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word to us. We ask, oh God, that you'll give us receptive hearts, receptive minds to listen to your word and to obey your word and to live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. For man shall not live by bread alone, but by the word of God. And I pray, oh God, that you would download your word in our hearts and our minds. Change and transform us by your word. Sanctify us by thy truth. Thy word is truth. Make us people of the book, so that we'll be ready for your second coming. While heads are bowed, eyes are closed, I wonder if there's a man, woman, boy, or girl sitting out there under the aegis of the Holy Spirit today. And you feel yourself so far away from God that you feel unworthy. You're in the right place. He's not counting on how many stripes you have, how many strikes you have against your name. He just wants to know, do you want to come under his authority? So today, is there a man, a woman like that who says, listen, I'm like that servant. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I feel empty. I'm going down and I'm checking out. And what is life all about? I have no joy, no power, no peace. But today, the word of God comes your way.
an invitation. Jesus presents to you the Word of God. Genesis to Revelation. In fact, he says, I am the Word. And he that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. Somebody today needing a closer walk with God today, and you want to come under his authority, just raise your hand by the grace of God. Want to come under his authority today by the grace of God. Want to bring your life in harmony with his word. Perhaps, praise God for you, perhaps there's someone else, praise God for you, someone else who is not a church member today. Pastor, I've been trying to do this thing myself. I feel like God is calling me. I can sense his spirit working on me. And today you want to say, Lord, I'm tired of fighting his spirit. I just want to surrender my life to him today. I need some help from him and his word. Just raise your hand. I want to put it up and put it down. I want to pray for you today. Somebody today in the balcony, someone across this congregation, not a member of the church, but you want to be a member of God's family. And you know that without him, you're fighting a losing battle. But with him, you can stand on his promises and you can make it. Somebody like that today? Don't be ashamed. Don't worry about the person beside you or behind you. Just raise your hand. Pastor, pray for me. I feel so out of it. But today I feel an invitation from heaven to join him today. By the grace of God, just raise your hand. Put it down. I want to pray for you. Put your hand up and put it down. Praise God for you, sir. Someone else today? Someone else today? Someone else today? This is where God breaks chains. This is where God sets captives free. This is where he liberates people. This is the moment that the Holy Spirit taps into your heart and gives you a breakthrough before you have your breakdown. So today, before you go another step, before you go another day, before you go another minute, you got 60 seconds in it. Didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to you to use it. You can suffer if you lose it. Give it a count if you abuse it. Just a tiny little minute, but your eternity may be in it. Somebody else today? Praise God for you. Someone else today? Not a member of the church. Pastor, pray for me. Praise God for you, sir. Someone else today? I'm a living test. Yes, yes, yes. Praise God for you. Someone else today? Oh, let's sing this song. Let's sing this song, the praise team.
God restore.
Yes, yes, he does. Yes, he does. He can restore. Someone else today? You're broken. You're hurting. You're in pain. You're disconnected. You have no life. But today Christ offers you life. I want to raise your hand. God restores.
God restores.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Sing it.
God restores.
Let him restore you. Let him redeem you. Let him bring you back to his purpose for your life. And with his healing hand, yes, yes,
I'm made whole. He makes my life complete.
Yes, yes,
my reunion is so sweet.
I'm a living testimony.
I'm a living testimony.
If you're a living testimony, why don't you stand on your feet? Let's sing this song together in praise to God.
God restore.
Yes, he does.
God restore.
My God
restore.
Yes, he does.
God restore.
restores my mind. Magnify the Lord with me. Exalt his name together. Give the Lord some praise, for God restores.